Welcome to Popular Culture. I'm Chris Richardson. I'm going to be teaching this class, and I look forward to getting to know you and your projects and your ideas throughout the year. I'm going to be posting these videos, and weekly there's going to be associated assignments, but today I just want to sort of introduce what the class is about, maybe what popular culture is. I mean, I'm sure you have a vague idea of what it is, but what does it really mean to take a course called Introduction to Cultural Theory and Popular Culture? That's what I want to do today, and like I said, look forward to getting to know you better. A little bit about me. I did my Bachelor of Journalism and a minor in Sociology in Toronto. Then I went on to get a Interdisciplinary Studies Master's of Popular Culture at Brock University near Niagara Falls, Ontario. And so, yeah, I have a background in popular culture and cultural theory. And then my PhD is in Media Studies, and I've done a lot of work on representations, particularly of gangs and crime in pop culture, in film, and journalism. And that's kind of where I'm coming from. Now I'm chair currently of the Communication Studies Department at Young Harris College, and I'm going to be talking to you a lot about popular culture, about things probably you had never considered, at least not in the ways that we're going to talk about them. But let's get started. Let's start right away. Today we're going to talk about, you know, what it means to study popular culture, what the expectations are, how to begin this process. But first, I want to show you this video. It came out a few years ago, and it's from The Guardian in the UK. It's a newspaper. They're clearly trying to attract audiences, trying to get people to participate by maybe logging on to their website, by checking out their stuff, obviously by subscribing. And they released this interesting advertisement video. It was popular on YouTube, and it speaks for itself. So I wanted to show it to you, and I have a few questions that I'd like you to answer. Primarily, why do you think that the marketers behind this newspaper organization chose the story of the Big Bad Wolf and the Three Little Pigs, especially considering the audience, which I'll let you decide, but I don't think the children's story that you might have read growing up, the Three Little Pigs, is the same audience or the same demographic that they're going for. And yet, the Three Little Pigs seems really appropriate. And so check out this video and fill in the questions on the website, and I will be right back.
This isn't right. The three little pigs are the victims.
You threw down two houses. We got what you deserve.
But the pigs went too far.
You have every right to defend your property.
Boiling someone alive hardly constitutes reasonable
force. Somebody is going to break the law and intrude on
you. Can't protect yourself in your own home.
A man's home is his castle. If
someone tried to blow my house down, I'd do the same.
I knew the wolf. There's no way you could have blown down those houses. He had asthma.
But the wolf had asthma. So what's the truth about the pig's houses being blown down? Inside job.
There's no reason why those two houses, one made from straw, the other from wood, should have collapsed. Not even a healthy wolf's huff and puff could bring them down.
The three little pigs have confessed to conspiring to commit insurance fraud, framing the wolf in an attempt to cover their tracks. Their motive was financial, as they struggled to keep up with their mortgage repayments.
I can empathize with
I'm behind on my payments too.
How could this have happened?
I've lost everything.
Okay, so I'm curious to see what you got. Maybe you noticed that the story was controversial, and that what you thought you might have known if you grew up with the Three Little Pigs story is challenged in some ways. You get somewhat contemporary issues like the state, the police, the economy. These are things you probably weren't worried about when you were 3 years old and hearing the story, maybe for the first time, or 6 years old and trying to read the story yourself with maybe a picture book or something like that. And so there are a lot of interesting ways in which they use the Three Little Pigs. And it also highlights a number of things we're going to be talking about in the course, particularly issues of representation. What does representation mean, and how do things get represented, and by whom, and for what purposes? Those become very important questions. Also, what are the direct messages? So I think you could argue that with any advertisement, the direct message is buy this. That's the manifest content, we'll call it, where they want you to buy this, which is a subscription or which is the use of their website. But then there's also this sort of latent content, which relies on ideas that you are a modern person who wants to know the full story, who wants to go beyond the juvenile ideas that you might have had as a little kid. Now we're in this big conversation together, and there's lots of fake news and lots of craziness, and everything you thought you knew is more complicated, but we'll help you get there, and we want to be in conversation with you. Those are some of the ideas in this video. And you might have noticed, if you looked at some of the material for this class, I like this theme of this wolf, because the Big Bad Wolf is a great fables character. He appears in a number of different places throughout popular culture, and it's usually a he, almost always, is a really versatile symbol for a lot of different things. Take this next video, for example. So here is the Silly Symphony, which Disney produced in the 30s and 40s. And what they're doing is clearly sending a similar message, in that it's about the Three Little Pigs and the Big Bad Wolf. But obviously, the audience, the intended message, the aesthetics, the way things look, are very different than the last video you just saw. So I want you to answer the questions associated with this video and get back to me in a minute.
Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? Big bad wolf, big bad wolf. Who's afraid?
Okay, so you probably realize that the intended audience is significantly different. Children versus young adults or all the way up to senior citizens for The Guardian. Also, the intellectual sort of challenge is very different. I mean, you have simple characters doing simple things that make sense if you're designing a story for children. The Guardian obviously complicates things with their narrative, but they rely on hopefully you, the viewer, knowing or at least having a bit of an idea of what's going on with Three Little Pigs story so that you can follow the actual advertisement. And so they're adding more layers to it, which makes sense if you're directing your content towards more adult viewers. You may not have been familiar with this next video. It's an interesting case. As I said, the wolf character can be used in many, many different ways. Here, Silly Symphony from Disney has been modified during World War II. And so I'll let you decide what the message is here and why they might have used the Three Little Pigs again during World War II in America. I look forward to seeing what you've come up with in terms of why the wolf is used, how the wolf became a Nazi, and why that might be effective for their message. And also, the interesting thing, because today, what would you put as an armband if you were designing propaganda? It probably wouldn't be Nazis, although you never know. Today, with the conversations that I don't even want to get into right now about the political left and right in America, I think you can imagine that if the NRA was in charge of this Silly Symphony adaptation, it might look very different than if Black Lives Matter was in charge of this adaptation, and a number of other things. Also, and I hate to do this, but for the rest of the class, I'm going to ruin your childhood stories. I think you'll have a much better, deeper understanding of popular culture and the ideas surrounding that. But if that's not, if you really want to hold on to your childhood innocence and thinking that the Big Bad Wolf and the Three Little Pigs means nothing other than a basic story for children, and these kinds of stories are, you know, not layered at all, then this is probably not the right class for you. Like I said, your childhood understandings of the Three Little Pigs, kind of like what The Guardian was doing, will change significantly as you get better at understanding and interrogating representation, things like identity, things like encoding and decoding, which we'll talk about. Why does the wolf look the way he does? And why do the pigs look the way they do? And what do they represent, especially in 1930s and 1940s America? And what happens when you take that basic image and translate it into new and other interpretations, even though they're based on the Three Little Pigs fable? This can be a challenging thing because you might have noticed, and if you didn't, you will now, there are racial implications for this. The wolf looks different than the pigs. There are class distinctions. The pigs have homes, and the best pig has the best home, whereas the wolf seems to be a beggar and therefore seems to be poor. And so already it's giving messages to children about how the rich and the poor need to separate, and that the poor should not be encroaching on rich people's territory, or middle class, maybe you'd call it today. There's also issues of ethnicity. Like I said, the wolf is dark, but he also has a number of Jewish sort of characteristics that today might not be so familiar, but in the 1930s were definitely familiar with certain stereotypes. And so it's interesting that on one level, Disney, who again, I'm ruining your childhood here, but he was a clear anti-Semite if you look at the history of Walter Disney, the actual person. And so I don't think it's a coincidence that the wolf character can be aligned with a lot of Jewish stereotypes at the time, but also a lot of other stereotypes, and they can change what Stuart Hall calls the floating signifier. They can change as time changes with our understandings, right? As context change. So today, maybe you could use the wolf as a different ethnicity or as a different character. At the time in the 30s and 40s, he clearly represented certain things to certain people, and also articulated or combined with certain values, like I said, that poor people should stay away, that ethnic minorities should stay away, and that the three little pigs should live in harmony together in their sort of middle class existence. Again, probably not the message that you or your parents might have intended when you were reading it the first time, but watch the video again, you'll see it. What about modern iterations or modern representations of the wolf? We're going to be reading fables, a really interesting adaptation, sort of like what we've been looking at in comic book form, that deals with the big bad wolf and a number of other characters that you're familiar with, I'm sure, but you've probably never seen them in this way. And that's going to spark a lot of interesting conversation. But here, check out a few more representations and think about what they might mean. And as you're doing that, what you'll be doing is cultural studies, the beginning of it. You might not have all the vocabulary, you might not have all the underlying theories and ideas, but that's what we'll be doing in this class. What you're doing in asking yourself, why does this character look the way he does? Why does this group of people seem to be attracted to this story versus that story? What are the other implications of the way in which the aesthetic appears? Like, why do cartoons appear one way? Why do live action films appear another way? Why does the music change significantly in the clips that we're viewing? All of these things represent signification. And signification and the ideas underlying them are basically one of the main elements of what we'll be studying in popular culture. So check out these other things, these other videos, and answer the questions associated with them. And then I'll be right back to introduce some basic ideas about what popular culture is and how we might study it.
We can't do this anymore.
They've arranged for you to marry Henry Lazar.
What do we do now? I'd do anything to be with you.
It killed again. The wolf.
In daytime, the werewolf returns to its human form.
The wolf is someone in this village.
Happy again. Come away with me.
You better watch yourself.
The wolf is coming. You're gonna get what you deserve.
Is that your car on the lot?
Yeah.
You show me a pay stub, I quit my job right now. Hey, listen, I quit. Yeah, I'm going into stocks.
My name is Jordan Belfort. I started my own firm out of an abandoned auto body shop.
I love my country, I love Jesus Christ, and I love making people rich.
Hello?
You don't want to get a bad reputation.
You just tried to bribe a federal officer.
Trying to make a name for ourselves.
The Wolf of Wall Street.
We don't work for you, man.
You have my money taped to your boobs. Okay, technically you do.
So now you've seen a number of different wolf ideas, right? We have the childhood fable of the wolf who comes in and the pigs have to run away, and it's just a clear bad guy. The wolf is a bad guy. If later we realize that the wolf might have been associated with certain political concerns, certain racist concerns, certain classist concerns, all of that kind of fits in later. But as a kid, you just understand the wolf is bad, the pigs are good, you want the pigs to survive. Easy, right? What about when we get to the wolf representing possibly a threat to one's purity or sexuality, as we see in the Red Riding Hood film adaptation? Then we have to ask ourselves, like, what does Red Riding Hood represent in this case? And what does the wolf represent in this case as well? Maybe you've seen that film, maybe you haven't, but watch that video again and try not to think about adolescent sexuality and the threat of the virgin being deflowered and the community getting together to prevent that from happening. I mean, that's what this story is about. And it's obviously appealing to teens who are maybe thinking about, if not actually being sexually active. And so that's clearly who that intended audience is, as opposed to early childhood viewers of Silly Symphony, but also maybe more mature viewers who really are not so worried about sexuality anymore. It's kind of been there, done that kind of thing. There's a reason that that film appeals, or is designed to appeal, to a certain group of people who are possibly getting sexually active at that time. Maybe you didn't think about that when you first saw it, but watch it again and ask yourself, why is it red? Why is there so much red? What does the wolf represent? It's impossible not to see it now. And then what about The Wolf of Wall Street? So The Wolf of Wall Street clearly doesn't represent this exact same things, but he has a lot of characteristics that are similar, right? In this case, think about when the film came out and when the film takes place. So the film came out more recently. The film takes place in the 80s. What's going on in the 80s and who are the big bad wolves? They're on Wall Street. At least that's one popular discourse, right? They're taking advantage of a vulnerable group of people. Instead of young women, it's people who have little money and are looking to invest. It's people who are trying to make a retirement fund for themselves. And then the big bad wolf is not trying to eat them. He's trying to take away their money and use it for selfish reasons. And so The Wolf of Wall Street comes out just after the 2008 economic crash in America and the world. And it's used as a way of talking about the big bad wolf in the sense of the financial markets. That's not a coincidence. That's a very purposeful use of what we'll later talk about in terms of signification, in terms of metaphor, in terms of articulation. And there's a whole bunch of other things we can discuss in relation to that. Now, what I want to do is simply introduce what it means to, what popular culture means and what it means to study it. And we'll do that in the next video.